Chapter 2, Michigan. Angelo Poffo and I left to Michigan in April of 1963, where we started working for Bert Ruby. Bert's partner in the territory was Jack Britton, who controlled all the midget wrestlers, such as Fuzzy Cupid and Little Beaver. Bert and Jack had an office at the Eddystone Hotel, and across the street was another hotel called the Paul Revere Hotel, which is where I stayed. Michigan is where I dropped the Hurricane Hart name and officially became Playboy Gary Hart. I was excited to finally be using the name, and I added the Playboy in homage to my hometown Chicago, where Playboy magazine was based out of. One night, Angelo and I were in Akron, Ohio. Bear and alligator wrestling were scheduled for the evening, but the guy that was supposed to wrestle them didn't show up. The promoter, Pedro Martinez, told me that if I wrestled the bear and the alligator, I would get an extra $50 payoff. At that time, I was making $25 a night, so I jumped at the chance to make more money. Before the match, the bear's trainer told me to stay behind the bear and ride him, and that eventually, the bear would reach back and flip me over. Then, we could go around like amateur wrestlers. So I went out there and did what he said, and I actually had a pretty decent match with the bear. Wrestling the alligator was a little different, however. The trainer told me that alligators have tremendous power closing their mouths, but almost no power at all opening them. I was assured that he would be cold and sleepy when the match started, so I was to immediately jump on his back and half Nelson him, keeping my hand over his mouth so he couldn't raise it. When the time came for my match with the alligator, his box was put in the ring and the trainer started pounding on the sides. I was the cue for the alligator to crawl out. They kept hitting the box, but there was no sign of the alligator. They finally tipped the box on the second rope and outslid the alligator. Immediately, I jumped on his back, clamped his mouth shut and started rolling around with him. He was completely unresponsive, so I got off the alligator, grabbed him by his tail, and pulled on him a little bit. At first, the audience was gasping ooh and ah, but eventually, the match started going nowhere quick, so I eventually rolled the alligator over and covered him for the pin. After I pinned him, I got up, and the alligator stayed on his back. It turns out I had been wrestling a dead alligator. If that wasn't enough, the people started booing me because they thought I had killed it. To top it off, Pedro Martinez didn't want to pay me the $50. Because the alligator was dead and the match didn't count. When I demanded my money, he taunted, "What are you going to do about it, punk?" I pulled out a razor and said, "I'm going to take this razor and cut you across the top of your head." I always carried a razor with me, and had used it in scuffles I had when collecting money with Sam Casino. I did not like being intimidated or messed with, and I would have had no problem cutting him for my $50. He sensed that I was prepared to do it, so he immediately gave me my money, but I was still pissed. Before Angelo and I left that night, I grabbed a car jack and broke the headlights, front windshield, and rear window of the hearse that Pedro Martinez rode in. He was so fat that he actually rented a hearse and had someone chauffeur him around while he slept in the back. After what I did, though, there was no way that fat bastard would be able to get any sleep during his trip back to Cleveland that night, but that's what he got for trying to stiff me. During the summer of 1963, Angelo quit wrestling because he had accepted a gym teacher position at a school in the south side of Chicago. I was sad to see him go, because he had afforded me a great opportunity in wrestling, and I will never forget how much he did for me. Once he left, though, Bert Ruby encouraged me to go around and wrestle as a single, suggesting I keep an eye on the talent to see if there was anyone else I would like to manage. At the time, Bert had guys like Leaving Larry Shane, Louis Klein, Crybaby George Cannon, Flying Fred Curry, Gino Brito, and Jim Myers on his roster. The only one that really caught my eye was Jim, but he already had a tag team partner and manager named Louis Pompano. However, as fate would have it, soon after I noticed Jim, Louis had a heart attack and died, and that was when I made my move. Jim had been wrestling for 1 year, and since I had been around the business for 5 years, Bert was pleased that I offered to take him under my wing. Although Jim was interested in having me manage and develop his career, he made it clear to me from the get-go that he was not interested in becoming a full-time wrestler. His main love was teaching, which is what he did during the workweek. Wrestling came second. I had a clear understanding of that from the beginning, but still, I saw something incredibly special in Jim and was determined to develop his career, so he could fully realize his potential in the wrestling business. We were an odd pair, to say the least. I was a street kid from Chicago who used to run with the mob, and he was a college graduate from Michigan State, a teacher in the Detroit school system, and 6 years my senior. Boy, does that sound like a buddy film gone bad, or what? It actually surprised me that we clicked together so good, because we bonded really quickly, and became the most unlikely of friends. Jim and I spent a lot of time together, and really traveled together a lot. I would pick him up at school at 4 p.m., we would drive to whatever town we were supposed to be in that night, and after the matches, we would be back home by 2 a.m. The next day, Jim would get up and go to school, and I would sleep all day. At the time, Jim wrestled under a mask and was billed as the student. His gimmick was that he was a student of wrestling, and the announcer, Alan Ruby, who just so happened to be the promoter's son, would invariably ask me why I constantly referred to him as the student of wrestling when he never used a hold, to which I would become over-defensive and angrily insist, "He's trying to learn. Give him time. He will develop." Eventually, Jim started using his first hold, a finishing maneuver called the hammerlock. The student would pick up his hapless opponent by the arm and walk around the ring with him, forcing him to submit. I would then jump in the ring, instruct him to drop the hold, and then march over to Alan Ruby's desk and order him to tell the people that the student was clearly learning, and that they should shower him with applause and recognition. After I forced him to make those announcements several times, Alan got tired of my bullying, refused to acquiesce to my demands, threw down his microphone, and stormed off the set. That was, of course, the setup for a feud between myself and Alan Ruby, and was the first time I ever had a one hand tied behind my back match. We had that match throughout Michigan, and the audiences loved it. It was in Michigan where I realized that I had a knack for coming up with clever finishes, and the other guys in the dressing room quickly picked up on it, as well. After hearing me give my ideas to Jim every night, some of the other wrestlers started approaching me to see if I had any good ideas for their matches. Jim pulled me aside one night and told me not to give away my ideas, pointing out that we were competing against them as it was, so if I started giving them my ideas, we would be competing with me, to boot. In no time, the student had become a tremendous attraction, and before we knew it, we were Bert Ruby's top heels. Jim and I were so successful that we started to get noticed by promoters from other territories. It was in early 1964 that I was first introduced to a promoter named Jim Barnett, because he had come to Michigan scouting talent for his new promotion that he was starting in Australia that year. Picture Elton John 20 pounds lighter, and that's what Jim Barnett looked like back then. He wanted to bring me and Jim Myers over to Australia, but we had to turn it down, because the tour would have interfered with Jim's teaching gig. That was all right, because there were other promoters interested in us, as well. Bert ran all of Michigan except for Detroit, which was run by Eddie Farhat, aka Sheik. Bert's promotion did air on Detroit television, though, so eventually the Sheik contacted Bert and asked if he could use me and Jim in the Cobo Arena, and on his TV in Windsor, Canada. Bert agreed, and the Sheik started booking us regularly. Since we were Bert Ruby's guys, and not the Sheik's, some of the guys on his crew would look down on us. That was because Bert Ruby's promotion was looked at as minor league, and I understood that. When I went to work for Bert after leaving Chicago, I considered it a step down, because he didn't use the NWA logo, the NWA champion, and like I mentioned earlier, didn't even run in Detroit. Lord Athol Layton had been a wrestler of some note in the Toronto area, and he ended up becoming the announcer for the Sheik. From day one, Lord Layton treated me and Jim like we were secondhand trash because we worked for Bert Ruby. He walked around like a big shot and treated Jim and I like a couple of local yokels. Jim and I didn't care, though. We just ignored him and anyone else who looked down on us for our association with Bert, and focused on getting ourselves over in Detroit. For one particular television taping, Jim and I came up with something to really get some heat. The student was wrestling a young kid, and he would constantly throw him out of the ring so I could get some cheap shots in from alongside the ring. The fans were going crazy, and then suddenly and completely unbeknownst to me, Lord Athol Layton jumped up from his announcing position and grabbed me, telling me to cut it out or we would get kicked off of TV. This wasn't an angle. This was his ego and sheer dislike for me taking over. However, there was such a tremendous reaction by the fans when Lord Athol Layton grabbed me that the Sheik booked us in a match at the Cobo Arena. The other main event that night was the student versus Bobo Brazil. Now the only reason Jim and I got those plum spots at the Cobo was because the Sheik had a real bad case of hemorrhoids, and needed to have an operation on his ass. His hemorrhoids were so severe that he had to shove a large Kotex up his crack because of the constant bleeding. Since he was going to have to miss one of the shows at the Cobo, he was outwardly telling people that he was worried the show wouldn't draw without him, but he was secretly panicked that someone else would do better business and usurp his top spot in Detroit. Therefore, the Sheik put me and Jim in the top two matches that night because he wanted guys in the main event spots who he felt he could control. Lo and behold, we packed the arena that night. Regardless of how good we did, though, the Sheik quickly pushed us down the card and never capitalized on our main event successes. He definitely continued using us, but would never let us get higher than the semifinal. I would like to mention that even though I knew that Bert Ruby didn't get a lot of respect in the business, I also knew I was very fortunate to be working for him. Bert was from Hungary, and had escaped during the early days of World War II before Hitler came through. He immigrated to the States and was always grateful to America. And even though he was not a big-time promoter, he developed a lot of talent such as Killer Kowalski, The Sheik, Brute Bernard, Bulldog Brower, and many others. I listened to every word he had to say, and after having a mentor like Billy Goals, I was very fortunate to have found such a wonderful second mentor in Bert. At the time, Bruno Sammartino was the WWF champion, and he would come into the Kobo Arena every now and then to defend his title. Whenever he would come in, he would be surrounded by an entourage of guys like Angelo Savoldi, Arnold Scholland, and Phil Zacco, and was basically unapproachable. In February 1966, Bruno and his crew saw Jim Myers in the ring as the student, and were so impressed that they asked him to come to Bruno's territory in Pittsburgh for a weekend. Since I wasn't invited, I didn't go. Jim was stunned when he came back, because he had wrestled in high school auditoriums and made $500 each night. In Michigan, meanwhile, we were making $100 a night wrestling at the Kobo Arena. Eventually, Bruno asked Jim to wrestle in Pittsburgh full-time, promising to only book him on weekends so it wouldn't interfere with his teaching job. Combined with his teaching gig, they guaranteed Jim a great living. Unfortunately, they weren't interested in me, and Jim asked if I would have any hard feelings if he took the job. Of course I didn't, and felt that whatever was best for Jim was best for me. So after more than 2 years together, Jim Myers and I parted ways. I'm proud to say that we began as friends and parted as friends, and to this day we're still best buddies and talk a couple of times a month. He's the greatest guy you would ever want to meet, was the first guy in the industry that I became close to on a personal level, and is like a brother to me. Of course, after his run in Pittsburgh, Bruno introduced Jim to Vince McMahon in the WWF, and Jim became a staple in New York as George the Animal Steel. Aside from the money, it was completely understandable why Jim wanted to get out of Michigan. With the Sheik as the main event wrestler in Detroit, he would never get an opportunity to move up on the card, and would forever be toiling away on the semi-main event. Plus, we didn't know it at the time, but the Sheik was doing everything in his power to keep me and Jim down. Frank Tunney and his nephew Jack used to come to Detroit regularly to scout talent for their promotion in Toronto. Jack Tunney told Jim many years later that he and his uncle had tried to get Jim and I booked in Toronto, but the Sheik kept preventing it from happening, claiming we didn't want to. Killer Carl Cox was a major wrestling star, and was wrestling for Dory Funk, Sr. in Amarillo. He came up to Detroit for a brief tour, really took a liking to me, and asked me if I would be interested in moving to Amarillo. We talked for a bit, and then he put me on the phone with Dory Funk, Sr., who asked if I would be interested in wrestling for him. I explained that I really enjoyed managing and developing talent, and that I wasn't sure I wanted to make my living solely as a full-time wrestler. Dory Sr. was very blunt, and told me that he didn't use managers and wasn't interested in me as a manager, but that he would hire me as a wrestler. Even though I wasn't thrilled with the prospect of going to a territory where I was only getting an opportunity to wrestle, it was time to move on. My experience with Jim Myers really built my confidence in molding and developing wrestlers, though, and I loved every second of it. I knew that I would eventually concentrate on managing and developing talent, but for now my sights were set on continuing my wrestling career in Amarillo, Texas.